Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. There is nothing more exciting for the digital age than the Howard Dean campaign, because that campaign is driven by the internet. The question tonight is, will or can the net elect Dean? And joining us tonight to discuss that is Diane Straus Tucker, who is a member of the executive committee of the Howard Dean campaign, and in real life, group publisher, Manhattan Media. And for our purposes, and for the audience purposes to start with, a fellow student, I should say, I want to say classmate, was at Yale. And I think this gives us an extraordinary opportunity to find out not only how the net will elect Dean, or may not, but what's the real Howard Dean? So I want to ask you, when did you first meet Howard Dean?
I first met Howard Dean in 1969. I was in the first class of women at Yale. And when we got to Yale, there were no older women, so Yale gave us each a big brother to show us around the campus. And my big brother was Howard Dean's roommate, Dave Berg. So they were—
David Berg.
David Berg. And David and Howard took me under their wing and showed me, you know, the dining hall and the gym. And
the two of you.
Well, the two of them took me around, yeah. They were my big brothers. That was an exciting time at Yale because in addition to co-education, it was, you know, civil rights and Vietnam.
Right.
And
I want to ask you about that, because one of the things I can't get clear in my head is Howard Dean, the Park Avenue boy, how he becomes Howard Dean, the Vermont doctor. But before we get there, you met this guy. Did you say to yourself, he will be the next president of the United States?
If you had asked me then, I could have named 100 guys I thought were running for president.
And in the class?
At Yale at that time. Yeah, you know that type.
Well, we got a lot of Yale.
Howard Dean.
We got a lot of Yale candidates now, because we got Dean, we got Kerry, we got
Lieberman. Bush.
Bush.
You heard of him?
Oh, yeah. He went to Yale. So it's a place where, at that period of time, was fostering a lot of political thought, so forth and so on. Well, what did you think if he wasn't going to—
That he was a great guy. He was a great guy. I had no idea. I would not have put him on that list of 100 guys running for president 35 years ago. But he was always fun to be around and full of life, full of energy, and always good at whatever he did. As you know, he left Yale not knowing he was going to be in politics.
Right.
He left Yale not knowing what he was going to do, and went skiing, came back, became a doctor, which was a total shift in direction. No one in his family had been a doctor, and went through medical school in 3 years instead of four, married a doctor.
Went 3 years instead of Well, okay, so we know when we listen to Howard Dean, and I want to make it clear, I'm not a Howard Dean supporter. But I think there's nothing more exciting, as I said at the beginning of the show, of the impact of the net on Dean, and that's why we're talking about him. And I have watched him campaigning, and when we watch him campaign, we know he's very, very smart. Did you think he was very, very smart when you met him at Yale?
Yes.
Tell the truth.
No, I did. I did. It didn't stand out as he was, you know, the smartest guy at Yale, because there were a lot of smartest guys at Yale. And he didn't intimidate people. Some of the really smart guys at Yale, Paul Krugman was a really smart guy at Yale,
who was
a little bit intimidating.
He's the columnist for the New York Times, liberal columnist. Well,
but Dean doesn't—
Was he a party boy the way George Bush was? Was he in a fraternity?
No, he wasn't in a fraternity. Yeah. Yes, he liked to have a good time.
He had a good time.
Yeah.
So how do we explain one of many at Yale, good guy, so forth and so on, who suddenly becomes this, I would have to say, brilliant speaker? I think he's one of the best campaigners. How do we account for this transformation? I just don't understand it.
I don't think he suddenly became it. I think he's grown. He moved to Vermont as a physician, then he got involved in politics and grew. became lieutenant governor, became governor, was reelected 5 times to the governorship of Vermont. And each year, his mom, with whom I've traveled some on the campaign trail, says he got better and better and better.
Oh, really?
Yes. And I'm seeing that in the campaign, too. If even measuring the debates, he's just getting better and better and better. And he has a vision of what the presidency should be, I think, that he's growing into.
Well, let me ask you this. Some people think that the death of his brother in Vietnam motivated
him. Laos, I think.
Now, what interests me is that we take upper-class WASPs who have become president in the United States. I shouldn't use WASP, I'm going to include Kennedy, but upper-class prep school types, let's call it that. Take Roosevelt, okay? People thought nothing of him in college. Kennedy, some a bit, but he was a real screw-off in prep school. And a lot of people think those two people, out of that background, became what they became because of tragedies in their life. Infantile paralysis in the case of Roosevelt, and the death of Joe Kennedy, Jack Kennedy's brother. Do you think that the death of, what is Charlie, isn't it? Charlie Dean had an impact that made him go. He still wears his brother's belt and all that sort of thing. Do psychoanalysis here for a moment. Do you think that was a big...
I do. I'm not a psychologist or psychiatrist, but I do think it had a profound impact on him. I think it showed him that life is precarious and short, and that making money was not something that particularly interested the governor. Charlie was apparently the politician in the family. I mean, the governor says if he were alive today, he'd be running for president, and I'd be his campaign manager.
Let's take a look at a family picture. I want to come back to Vietnam and Yale. Let's not forget that, but let's take a look at the family picture for a moment, because there's one person in the family picture I want to talk about, and that's Governor Dean's mother. And you have recently been campaigning with Governor Dean's mother on the same plane with her. And so I guess you must be a confident, how are you, real confident of the family?
I'm very fond of Andre Dean, and she is growing into this too.
She's in the middle of that picture as you saw it, right?
Right.
And she looks to me like a real, I almost want to say bombshell. She's a very attractive, very attractive woman. What is her influence on who's, where's the influence here? Howard Dean's father was a real conservative Wall Street banker who introduced his son to his friends in Wall Street. Meet my communist friend. That's not fair, because that means he's really liberal. I don't think Dean's as liberal as everyone said. He wouldn't support Dukakis in 88. But there's the father, but no one knows about the mother. Is the mother a big influence?
When the governor's asked, where do you get your energy, because no one has campaigned as hard as the governor has for this last 2 years, he says, my mother. And after traveling with her, I see that. She is amazing, never gets tired, you know, gets up ready to roll every day, new places, new people, and she's terrific, with real empathy for everybody.
So the picture you get of Howard Dean's father is not one who has empathy for a lot of people necessarily. I don't want to be too unfair, but that's not the picture you get. He's the Wall Street stockbroker who has the dirty jokes on his card. I mean, he may have been a perfectly nice person, but you don't get the idea of empathy. And is that where this comes from? Because certainly Dean has extraordinary empathy
for all sorts of
people. So you think it comes from her?
I do.
And she's still a hot pistol?
She is absolutely a hot pistol. She was back at Columbia when the governor went to register for medical school. She was there because she'd gone back to school taking art courses, and she appraises art. I mean, she's just continually curious about the world. We go places and she notices things I haven't noticed about people.
So there's the story, that's the untold story maybe about this campaign. We had, thought maybe Dean Niak campaign people think recently an unfortunate article about Howard Dean's wife, who's portrayed as an introvert who doesn't want to come out of the kitchen except to practice. But is that a fair characterization?
No. I didn't think that was an unflattering article.
A lot of people marry their mother. Is she like his mother?
In the sense of being independent, I mean, Judy is a doctor from a family of doctors, and she takes that profession seriously. She wrote a wonderful letter this summer saying, Howard has never made his political aspirations my personal obligations. She's totally supportive. I have stayed at their house when the governor was on the road, and Judy is as intelligent as anybody about the campaign. Anybody. And very involved. She just doesn't want to go out and look adoringly at every word. She's heard the speech. She's totally supportive, totally excited, but doesn't feel, and the governor has said, I'm not going to use her as a prop. You know, he's going to do this, and she'd certainly move to Washington, and she'd certainly be a wonderful first lady, and I think sets a new role for the first lady, that you can be two independent people with careers. That's true of most of the families in this country, by the way, right now.
That well, let me ask another question I don't see you ask very often, what I would call a sect question. She's Jewish, and her children were raised as are raised as Jews. That's a little surprising in a mixed marriage, isn't it?
It's true of mine too.
True of yours too. Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Do you think I won't get into your personal life or necessarily hers with her children? But I want to ask: what sort of impact do you think that'll have on the campaign? Not many people talking about it. Maybe that's will have no impact.
I think it just confirms his commitment to Israel. And his understanding. I mean, he celebrated Hanukkah, he celebrates Christmas. He understands, a lot of different issues for a lot of different people.
Okay, let's go back to his mother. Now, his mother apparently said, when he told her he's going to run for president, that is the craziest idea I have ever heard. Now, when you first heard about the campaign, and I want to ask you when, did you say to yourself, this is the craziest idea ever?
No.
No, you thought he was going to be a winner right from the beginning.
I did.
Really?
3 or 4 years ago, a couple of his roommates and I said, if he ever runs for president, we're going to drop everything and help because he'd be fabulous. And he called 2 years ago. He's a terrific candidate, and we all knew.
No, but it's four years ago.
He wasn't.
It's hard to keep track of where he was. I mean, see Howard Dean on TV maybe for 2 minutes once a year, and I say, well, gee, that's pretty good, but, you know, not enough exposure. How did you keep up with him?
We skied in Vermont in the winter every year, and so we'd see him once a year. I remember meeting him on the octagonal restaurant on top of Stowe somewhere with my kids, and my eldest saying to me, Mom, that can't be the governor in that funny-looking helmet. It just can't be. But we'd see him, and then you'd see him on TV up there, and he was a terrific governor. I mean, he appointed a cousin of mine to be state's attorney in one of the counties, and he has a lot of terrific people around him there. And then the civil unions bill came up and it passed, and he handled it brilliantly.
And do you think that's going to hurt him?
I don't.
When he goes down, how is he going to go down south and say?
It's about civil rights, you know. It's about rights for all Americans under the law. And now other states are following 5 or 6 years later, New Jersey most recently. And he realized he could be president, and we all thought so too. And so he called.
You always thought so from the beginning?
Yes.
I want to get back to that. A lot of things I'm going to get back to. So let's go back to the issue that I kept putting off, and that was Yale. In the 70s, everyone I would think who's watching this program would say, Yale, typical Yale looks like me. And a typical Yale woman looks like you, okay? And how in Lord's name could Yale be a hotbed of anything that would perhaps turn some people around? He roomed, by the way, with two black roommates, which is rather unusual for
Dawson and Don Roman, he had requested when he got there.
That's a little unusual for someone from Park Avenue or prep school to ask for.
He'd taken a year in England before Yale. His mother says, I sent him over there expecting him to come back in, you know, Savile Row suits, and he came back a hippie.
In England?
In England. And one of his roommates there was from with a king's son from Nigeria or something, so he'd spent spring break in Nigeria and seen Africa. He's traveled, he's visited over 50 countries.
Right.
He's always been curious about other parts of the world. And
did Yale turn him on even more?
I'm sure it did. He majored in political science.
But
there.
Yale was a hotbed then.
Yale was a hotbed then.
That's the answer to that question.
Yeah, right,
because
right.
of, Well, 1969 was a hotbed year for anyone in college, and you're shortly at. Well, it is 1969 when you started.
We had, you know, the Black Panthers and Vietnam, right. And Ralph Dawson, one of his roommates that year, went on to become head of the Black Student Alliance on campus. He was the politician. Howard Dean wasn't it.
Really?
Ralph Dawson is now a surrogate speaker for the governor in South Carolina, where he's from. Oh, yeah, all.
Oh, they're both in the.
Not both. I mean, there are 10 of us from those days
really?
Who were doing things in different parts of the country. And one of the geniuses of this campaign is it's allowed people who want to contribute in whatever ways they can.
Okay, now the real genius of this campaign is the use of the net. And who thought of that?
I think Joe Trippi obviously gets
a
lot. He's campaign manager and formerly of Trippi McMahon, which is a consulting firm which had used the net, clearly gets a lot of the credit. Howard Dean gets the most credit because our supporters had to find us. It's not like you can really use the net to go out and find people, but he's created an environment there that is exciting and interesting that people want to come and find.
When you had that first campaign meeting, was it 2 years ago? Was the first meeting of the executive committee? Was it up in Burlington?
There are often conference calls.
The first retreat was
in Burlington. We do retreats
too. For your first retreat, which was some time ago, did people talk about the net then?
Yes, but Joe was very clear that we needed traditional donors too. I mean, it's really been sort of 50-50 traditional donors and the net, and you put the, and either half would be great, and you put them together, and it's just overwhelmingly
But did Trippi
effective.
Say at that point in time, I think I can raise half the money from the net?
No, we didn't know that.
I know
Stephanie Shriok, the director of finance, when she got to the office and Joe Trippi got to the office, Stephanie said, Joe, look at this. And money was coming in over the internet already, just little amounts.
But why was
people
that?
Felt so strongly about Howard Dean.
But I don't understand that, because you have seven or eight, a dozen, a million candidates for president. They're all in a pack 2 years ago.
He has had a message from the beginning of honesty and being outside of Washington and wanting a new start there.
Did he have a website to start with?
Yes, but it wasn't breathtaking. I mean, if you go to it now, and it's www.deanforamerica.com, and that first page is the home page. The second page is the official blog, which gets people people get up in the morning and go to that official blog.
Well, let me tell you my reaction to the blog. I think I'm somewhat consonant with the net, because after all, I have this program.
Right.
But then again, if you've looked at me, I'm not the class of 02, class of 02 at Yale. So I go on, but 2 days ago was the first day I went on the Dean blog. And I have to tell you, as someone who does look at the net in preparation for the show and anyway in other ways, my mind was blown away by that blog. And I would urge, whether you're a Bush supporter or anyone else out there, to go out and look at
www.deanforamerica.com.
What struck me is I expect to see a lot of baloney. And what I found was really the best source for up-to-date political news on the campaign. Now, I don't have to go, as a consequence of looking at the blog necessarily, to watch CNBC and the latest stuff. I don't have to fight my way through the New York Times. In fact, I won't get as much, because right on the blog, I get everything that's going on in the campaign.
And everything that's been written that day.
And I get
about
all
it.
The links to everything. It's extraordinary. But the other thing that's extraordinary, from my view, is the sense of enthusiasm. Now, when did all that happen?
Well, it's happened throughout the year. It's been building and building, and that's been an incredible thing to watch, Jim. I mean, Jim Dean, the governor's brother, and I went up to Burlington a year ago, and there was $157,000 in the bank and a little office.
And this is just a year ago, Anna?
Yeah.
$157,000.
And we thought that was great. And then through this year, the excitement has built, and the group of people in this community has built. It has been the most incredible, and what a reflection on Governor Dean. I mean, the organization that he has built under him.
Let's just figure out what happens. You have a website that's not so great, but you have a message that says that I'm What does the message say? I'm a non-Washington, I'm an outsider, basically.
We want our country back, basically.
Was that up there from the beginning?
Yes.
Oh, we want our country back. And so that is the perfect message for the internet world, because the internet world's upside down. People can talk to each other and create a huge horizontal base. And it's not like the old-fashioned campaign where you shoot the message down and you try to get on the phone.
They have been brilliant.
So that idea, we can get the country back because, look, we're all here talking to each other.
It's up to us, and it's a grassroots movement. And they have been brilliant about not superimposing a traditional campaign and sort of bossing us around, but letting this grassroots movement grow through the net. And then brilliant about channeling it so that in meetups recently.
Meetup
started, it was an independent organization, is an independent organization. You could meet up if you're interested in backgammon, if you're interested in witchcraft, whatever.
Or girls, in my case.
I'll check. I don't know about that. So we started meeting up for Dean, and they grew and grew and grew. But, you know, we would talk about how vehemently we felt about this campaign, and then Joe Trippi had the idea of having us write handwritten letters to undecided voters in Iowa in these meetups, and they would be able to give you name and address of an undecided voter in Iowa. 70% of undecided voters in different states have now received letters from Dean people. That's amazing to use the internet to give you names and addresses.
I went on the site a couple of days ago, as I said, and I read two things that I thought were interesting. The one you just talked about. The first was, please don't call the office of the senator in a particular state because he can't handle all the phone calls. But it also said to write letters. Do you get the name of the person if you don't go to a meetup anyway from
You can get it now off. Some of my friends in other parts of the country are just downloading names to write to. That's what an effective way to feel you're doing something if you have a spare hour. You write handwritten letters, and it's the combination of this new technology.
No,
Al Gore and Bill Bradley got letters from Dean supporters before they endorsed. The power of this campaign, that, you know, the internet is like the base of it,
right.
But it's really the people that it's brought together and the enthusiasm they feel.
On the meetups, do you get just young people? Would you get someone like me at a meetup?
And lots like me.
What is the age?
Some of them are too young to vote, and they're there because they feel passionately, but they can't vote. I mean, 16, 17, up to 80s. People who want to take the country back. A lot of people our age who say, I haven't been involved in politics in 35 years, but my kid was working for Dean in New Hampshire or somewhere and got me involved. A lot of people coming back into the system, which is one of the beauties of this campaign.
Yeah, no, see, you know, a meetup, you could not do a meetup in a pre-internet era. It's just too hard.
You
have to get on the. Just this is why, you know, for those who watch this program and seen the net develop and see the tremendous impact on media society, which is the purpose of the program, can ask themselves, look. We could have a meetup in the old days. Well, you couldn't, because you had to get on the phone, and then you had to get on another phone.
It would be impossible.
So a meetup. Okay. So why can't the other candidates? Well, let me ask before I want to know why can't the other candidates do it. How much money have you raised from that? How much are you going to raise?
You have to check with the campaign
numbers,
but we've raised more money than any Democrat in history. We did $15 million this last quarter, 15.6, and I think 14.8 the quarter before, for a total of $40 million. And my guess is that it's half and half, net and not. I really don't know the exact numbers. But it keeps coming in over the net. But I want to get back to meetup for 1 minute, because I do feel that it's allowing communities to get to know each other. We use the internet to know when the next meetup is. You get to vote on a place, so that where there was one in Westchester, where I live, there are now five. And the same thing.
Are you still going to meetups?
Absolutely. It's the first Wednesday of every month.
Absolutely. Where do you go?
It's in Borders in Mount Kisco, but it's been in White Plains, and then it just grew too big for any one place. And that's happened
if you're in the campaign, and you want to do something useful. People always want to be in campaigns and do something useful, and all they're told to do is go raise $1,000.
No, and this way you but all go and go, get together, oh and you talk about, God. You go around the room, talk about how you get involved, why you're there, and they have you do something, whether it's getting petitions to get Governor Dean on the ballot, or writing letters, or there are people now going to or different states to be helpful. And the other fascinating experience I've had with this is there are house parties that people are giving to raise money. And the most success I had, you know, you call some of your friends, maybe they're away, you were allowed to request 20 names and phone numbers of people in your zip code who had donated to Dean. They all came to the party. These are neighbors of mine I had never met.
Really?
Never bumped into.
So then that is creating
communities.
Well, that happens in a campaign. And that's the fun of a campaign in the pre-net days, but it's not the same. But you don't get that many groups going. Now, why can't the other candidates do this? Why can't Bush do this?
I don't know if people are as interested in going out on a freezing Tuesday night and talking about some of the other candidates as they are about Howard Dean. I mean,
really?
They could. I heard of other candidates who actually sent spies to some of our meetups because it didn't seem possible. Mm-hmm. But these are real people excited about this candidate. I suppose they can.
So you wouldn't do a meetup with Bush because you're not curious about what they think about Bush because you already know about Bush. But how about the other candidates in the campaign on the Democratic side? They're just not interesting enough to...
I don't know.
Well, how about... how many people do you think you have on the net?
560,000.
Do you think that number can get larger?
Yes, we are hoping to have 2 million.
2 million people?
And if 2 million... And if 2 million people gave us each $100, that's the $200 million that George Bush is going to have.
Do you think that's going to happen?
We're the only... I do. And we're the only campaign that can make that happen.
And the campaign is... Well, we've come to an end. I was going to ask you a question, whether you can get out 4 million votes, and I guess the answer to that one is yes. Well, here's the end of the program, so here's the question. Will the net elect Dean?
My answer to you, Jim, is yes, and not only will it elect Dean, but the campaign is going to have names and email addresses of people all across the country who want to get involved. And so in close races, in House races and Senate races and gubernatorial races across the country, we're going to be able to make a difference. We raised money for Boswell in Iowa, and money has been trickling in ever since. $60,000 has been raised. It's a power not just to elect Dean to the White House, but to elect people in close races all across the country.
Diane Straus Tucker, thank
Jim
you very much
Goodale.
For coming by. And thank you for coming by, too. And come by next week to learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.